Welcome everyone. This is the interview with Grzegorz Domaradzki. Hi Gabz.
Hi Martin. So
he is an exceptional illustrator and digital artist with a unique style, mixing digital techniques with photorealistic pencil drawings. And I would like to do this interview to go through his style, his technique, and learn a bit about his background. So I hope you will enjoy this. Well, he has a really outstanding portfolio on Behance, and I'm going to include these links in the description as well, and you can also find it under the video in the post. He has around 1 million project views on Behance and more than 20,000 followers. And his work has been featured several times on Behance and other curated online galleries as well. He created artwork for companies such as Nike, Ubisoft, CD Projekt RED, Hasbro, Reebok, various movie posters, album covers, and even snowboard designs. So, first of all, can you talk a bit about your background, Gabz, and where do you live, where and what did you study, stuff like that?
Okay, man. Well, first of all, great introduction. Very flattering. Thank you. and not much to add, actually. We should call it.
Yeah.
But seriously speaking, well, the background, basically, I'm Polish. I live and work in Poznań, Poland. It's a city like 300 kilometers next to Polish capital, Warsaw. I studied at the Academy of Fine Arts in my hometown, in Poznań. I had my master's degree in graphic arts and drawing.
When did you start drawing on paper? I guess it was quite early on.
Well, yeah, I mean, I can't give you an exact date, that's for sure, but it was in a very early age. Basically, I was drawing from the very beginning. I loved to draw with crayons, color stuff, but I guess you can say that during high school, I was getting more and more focused on drawing with pencils. Basically, I wanted to achieve the level of Renaissance masters. That was my dream. To start drawing as realistically as possible. Mm-hmm. And then after high school, when people started saying, you are talented, you should consider studying, I kind of knew what I want to do with my life. So I chose the studies at the Academy of Fine Arts in Poznań, like I mentioned before, and that's how it went from there.
Cool. And when did you start using the computer to improve your artwork?
Well, computer appeared kind of late, what may come as a surprise to some of you guys. Because, well, when I was a teenager, I did have a PC computer, but I only used it for gaming. No software at all. Well, sometimes I did have fun in Paintbrush on Windows, but I'm not sure if that qualifies for using a computer. And during the studies, it was all about handcraft, if that's the right term. I was drawing everything by hand, well, or painting and sculpting as well, and not to mention the printing art techniques, which also involve press and that sort of objects or whatever. But still no computer. And right after the studies, I started working at advertising agency, first as an illustrator, so I was also drawing by hand, then scanning, and I slowly started learning Photoshop skills and other computer software. And basically, slow steps, every improvement at a time, I guess my skills started growing and you can say it took me to where I am now, more or less.
Okay, so Photoshop and Illustrator skills you picked up mainly when you already started working in these agencies and...
Yes, exactly. Well, it included a bit of help from my coworkers, especially one, his name was Piotr, Peter, and he sat a couple of times with me just to teach me the basics, and it helped a lot, at least at the beginning of the road.
Are you working full-time or are you a freelancer? And why did you choose this form of employment?
Well, I'm a freelancer. Like I mentioned already, I did my time, so to speak, in advertising agencies, and there were a couple on the way. I liked it. I learned some stuff. It was great to meet other creatives, work for big brands and stuff. But overall, it didn't suit my profile, so to speak. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe I have problems with authorities, maybe the bosses I encountered weren't just, you know, that great. But overall, though, like I said, it was a cool experience. I got kind of sick of it. I mean, working weekends, deadlines, brainstorming and all that. I just got bored of that quite quickly. And I decided to went freelance. Of course, decision like that is always kind of hard. I guess it takes balls to make this sort of decision.
Definitely.
And at first, it was a bit scary. It's never easy when you right at the beginning. But slowly, I managed to get recognized. More and more clients appeared, and suddenly it became obvious to me that being my own boss, choosing what to work on and what not to, mm-hmm. is for me at least the best possible option. Of course, it takes discipline, because I work at home, so one might think I sleep till noon. And work, I don't know, 2-3 hours or maybe like long hours. Whether it's like that or not, basically it takes discipline to find this is time for work, this is time for fun and other stuff.
Yeah.
But I would change freelancing for any other thing. I mean, this is, for me, it's just perfect.
That's great. And now that you are an established artist, how do you find clients or how do they find you? And are you working with agents?
Well, I do have agents, that is true. I mean, I'm lucky enough to have an agent in Spain and UK. I had one in Germany, but I think this company no longer exists. Plus, I'm represented in Poland as well. But to be true, I get around maybe 30% of my commissions via the agencies that represent me. Mm-hmm. And the rest are just clients that sort of find me, however that sounds. So answering your question is a bit tricky in a sense that I can't really say how they find me. I guess it's good to have a portfolio site, which I bet everyone knows who is watching that video, or at least should know. So maybe it's via my portfolio, maybe probably it's via Behance page, because like you said, I have a lot of followers, many of my projects got featured, and I know that a lot of creatives browse through Behance.net searching for possible artists. So I bet in many emails they actually mentioned they found me via Behance. So yeah, that's how it works. The more recognition you get, and by that I mean the more places you are on, the better.
Yeah, definitely. And I can see that you have a really good website as well, really to the point. All your work immediately comes up. Is that a pro site or is that something you did yourself?
No, actually it's a cargo-based mm-hmm. website. There's this site, everyone can Google it, Cargo Collective. They have awesome already made layouts, mm-hmm. so to speak, for lack of a better word. And you can choose from different skins, if that's the proper term, and plus you can customize it if you know anything about the HTML and other languages. I'm not too good at this, so I had my friend helping me out with that, but indeed my website is based on a cargo site, but it's customized slightly. Mm-hmm. Well, the idea was, and I hope it's clear to everyone who visits my website, that I am gabz.com. Is that I wanted everybody to see, like, right after visiting my website, what I'm doing. If someone is interested in particular work, he can click on it. Then he sees a larger preview, plus some close-up shots and info. But the idea of putting all my work and like on one page, which is easy to scroll just from up to down, and you can see, okay, this guy, I know this guy, maybe I've seen some of his work before, or maybe not, but wow. Some of these are pretty good looking. That was the idea of my website, just pure and clear. Actually, when I'm sometimes asked about for advice via email or otherwise, how should the website for an illustrator look like, sometimes I always say you should limit your work to just those that you like most. I mean, those that you're especially particularly proud of and that you still want to do, like, this is the work I still want to do stuff similar to. And I have to admit, some of the works on my side, I mean, there's a little bit too much works on my side right now. So I'm thinking about redesigning it, actually making it even simpler. Maybe sections like, you know, editorial posters and just all posters in one. I'm still thinking about it, but basically the simpler, the better, best works. That would be my advice.
Yeah, it's a very good advice to only limit your portfolio to work you want to actually continue doing in the future.
Sometimes I know, even I had the problem. For example, I did something for someone I considered a big client, you know, a big brand, but the work itself, even at the point of just being given the brief, wasn't that exciting, and the final outcome, even though it was, like, you know, solid, pretty good, wasn't astonishing, brilliant, and so on. And of course, there's this dilemma, you know, should I include this because it's for this brand, or should I, you know, forget about it because it's not that good? Mm. And my advice would be now,
not to force it.
From this point where I'm at now, just get rid of. I mean, lose the work.
Yeah.
You can mention the client. That's always something.
Yeah.
I mean, in your about contact section or whatever.
Yeah. That's very good advice, and I think whoever visits your website gets a really good idea of how to present their work, because, as I said, it's really to the point. Immediately see your work, and your unique style comes across immediately. And then if they want to find out more, in each project you have a good description. Sometimes you include videos as well, if it's like a poster for a film. And you have the contact details, a bit about yourself. So I think that's a very good example to follow as an artist.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Cool. I saw that you sometimes collaborate with people. Especially, I found one of your recent work was with Christoph. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing
Christoph, but close enough.
Yeah.
I guess.
Also known as KX2. Is he a relative of yours?
Well, he obviously is. To spice things up, so to speak, he's my twin brother.
Oh,
which
cool.
Is, so we had pretty much the same path of education. Well, not pretty much the same. The same. We studied the same stuff. We went to the same high school, same class, same primary school, and so on. So yeah, he's very similar to me. He also draws, of course. He's an illustrator, I think a great one, but who am I to judge? subjectively speaking, he's a great artist himself. And like you said, every now and then we like to collaborate. Sometimes it's, you know, a client is approaching me and asks for something, and I think, like, hey, why don't I do it with my brother? That was the case with snowboards we did together, and actually with that Teenage Mutant Ninja show, which you might have been referring to, I'm not sure. Anyhow, but sometimes, on the other hand, he gets a commission on which either he doesn't want to work on himself, or he doesn't have enough time, and then he invites me to help him out, and we do it together. It's easier since we're twins, so we understand each other in an instant. On the other hand, I just kind of have to add that we do argue, of course, sometimes kind of, you know, loudly over stuff, because we are both individuals, both twins. But overall, it's a great pleasure to working with your family, with someone as close as your twin brother, and I couldn't be happier. Every time we finalize something, we are always very happy.
That's great, and I'm sure you inspire each other as well. And whenever you look at each other's work, it also helps you to.
Yes, of course. I mean, hugely, actually. Maybe not to a point I love to admit it, but of course, some of my brother's works just blew me away. And even if I totally try not to, I just have it at the back of my head. And who knows, maybe some of the viewers might see some of the inspiration I take from my brother and vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably there, let's face it.
I guess that's a great thing, because whoever doesn't have a twin brother or a sister like yourself should still have at least some friends or even people through Behance that they can show their work to and get some critique and feedback.
Well, it's very important. I mean, no matter how good you are, it's always good to you know share your stuff with others so you know what they think. I mean, one might say artist produces for himself, but I don't think it's the case. I mean, in the end, it's the viewer, it's the client, whatever, who also needs to appreciate what you're doing. So it's great to have somebody like a twin brother in my case, or just a good friend, a designer, fellow, that can tell you whether he likes it or not. Just to be clear, I'm also in touch with quite a number of different designers from Poland and other countries, Italy, and so on. And I do share my works with not just with my twin brother. He's not always enough. Plus, he's on vacation sometimes, so I have to like to show it to other people and hear what they say.
Just to return back to a bit to your work now, is it possible to say how long does it take normally to finish an illustration? I know it's very depends on the actual work.
Yes, it's kind of hard since it depends on technique. As you and the viewers might have noticed, I operate, so to speak, in at least two like different techniques. One is purely digital. All the screen printed posters, for example, are done this technique. I can tell you about it a bit more in a way. And the other one is pencil based, where I just draw with a pencil, but scan the drawing, color it in Photoshop, and so on. And the second one is easier. I mean, it's less time absorbing, though it may be surprising, and usually takes up to, I don't know, 5 days. Let's say the Witcher 3, which was a big poster, though they printed it smaller, which I'm still surprised. I made it like, I think it's B1, basically 24 by 36 inch, sort of this size, and they printed it smaller. But this work, included a couple of drawings, which I later scanned, combined, and so on. And it took me like, I don't know, a week maybe. Mm-hmm. Tops. I think it's a pretty good time for this amount of work.
Definitely.
And I've got to say, I'm still very happy with this one. But and on the other hand, the screen printed posters are much more time consuming, though the size is pretty much the same as the Witcher which I made. But it includes, first of all, color separation. Each color has to be separate. Plus the digital style I'm using is very, very precise and like I said, time consuming. Sorry for just repeating that. And basically it takes up to 3 weeks to deliver that sort of screen print. That's why it costs more as well.
So would you be able to walk us through your process? You already mentioned a couple of things, but it would be great to see maybe with one of your projects to see it from the initial ideas to the final artwork. I know that you have some processes on Behance, but maybe if you can walk us through one of them in particular and then just talk a little bit more about the process.
So the question was about the process. So why don't I explain the process on The Witcher here, which you can find on my Behance profile. I'm gonna skip the close-ups. The process, basically it starts from the sketch, but believe me, the sketch is not as precise as this one you see here at the very beginning. At the very beginning, it's very, very rough, and usually, pretty much always not worth showing. That's why I'm not showing it either. It's basically a pen sketch in my notebook, just to get the glimpse of general composition and all. And this one you see here is sort of based already on a reference material I was provided with by CD Projekt RED. So it's all about moving all the elements back and forth, adding stuff, because obviously not all of the elements are taken from the game, like the birds on fire and small birds flying and etc. The guy hanging on the tree was recreated, though based on a first clip from the game revealed, which some of you might have seen. Anyhow, this is more or less how the sketch looks like, on which I'm drawing later on. So this I print, since as I told you, the size of this poster was pretty huge. I have to print it on A4 A4 format, like at least couple of times, if you know what I mean. I mean, every section, well, imagine basically the monster is on one sheet of paper, some part of the Witcher is on the other, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I draw everything separately, but sort of have it all in front of me just to make sure it will look good when combined. When combined and scanned, it looks more or less like this. Of course, there's also some levels added, which are always necessary when after scanning the pencil drawing. So this is a scanned drawing with levels applied. So yeah, so next step would be, and it is, though it may seem like, oh, it's just coloring, it's very time consuming, it's just like sort of selecting with color every important part of the imagery, including, you know, the teeth, the eye of the monster, the fire. Well, imagine selecting the fire. It's very
painstaking,
time consuming, and you gotta be patient. And then, like I said, I use a magic wand just to select the color I want to work on, and I'm adding few more layers, like shadows, lights, more shadows, super light on the top, and so on. I don't want to bore you with that, but this step includes a lot of work, and a lot of new layers appear during this process. Because, it's not that, you know, there's a set for just The Witcher or something. No. And, you know, all shadows are on everything. But like I said, there are multiple shadow layers, multiple light layers, many hue adjustments, hue saturation adjustment layers, and so on. To get this I don't know, level of digital coloring, it's a lot of new layers. I add a couple of hue saturation adjustment layers, sometimes selective colors, and other adjustment layers, and basically play with colors so they are not as wild and vivid. At least that was the intention in Witcher 3 in particular. So as you can see, I went towards browns, reds, yellows, and only a touch of blue at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the idea. And on this stage, which is the final, I added a bit more lightness, because I kind of felt that on this step I lost some of the drawing details, which I felt need to be exposed.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is just a bit more lightness, probably using the same selection I just described to you guys. And of course, I added the Witcher logo, which I was provided with. And yeah, that's it.
Cool.
The client was happy, at one point they weren't too happy with the sun, which was much more red, but they were worried it looks too Japanese, quote.
Oh.
so yeah, I had to turn it more into an orange, yellowish, because it was kind of flat red. I really liked it, but well, I like it now.
That's good. Thanks a lot for showing us your process on The Witcher, which is really a cool artwork. Okay, and as a finishing question, would you be able to just say a couple of things that you think might be useful for anyone who wants to get in the industry, do similar things, what you do, illustration, artwork for films and games? So what do you think are some crucial points? I know it's very difficult to summarize, and
yeah,
I don't want you to go into details. Just really a couple of crucial things that can be useful.
Yeah, of course. Well, of course, it's kind of hard to avoid a cliche at one point, given a question like you just gave me. But, you know, the answer is quite simple. I mean, dedication, you gotta love what you do. That's obvious, right? You gotta be dedicated, you gotta be well organized. It's good to be talented, or at least try and improve your skills as much as possible. Work hard, produce personal stuff whenever you have the time. Oh, I just told you guys, I don't have time for that anymore. But it's important. You know, even doing stuff for imaginary clients or brands you would love to work on, but they never contacted you yet. You know, imagine doing a redesign of Coca-Cola website. It's not forbidden, as long as you mention you're not the owner of the brand. So that sort of tip, that was a tip for web designers, but you can, you know, redesign the logo, do an illustration for a game you love as a personal project. There's loads of subject topics you can pick and just do whatever you want. It's good to experiment. I mean, trying out different filters, solutions, ideas. Of course, get inspired. By that I mean, watching what other people do. There's nothing wrong in stealing, but some solutions every now and then. I mean, not like copying stuff, like one to one, of course. But at least, you know, this is a good idea. I'm gonna use it just differently with a different title or whatever. I would never say it's nothing bad. As someone once said, good artists copy, great artists steal. So I'm somewhere in the middle. Mm-hmm. At least that's what I meant. Yeah, and I guess that's pretty much it. I mean, work hard, if I haven't mentioned that yet, because work hard pays off, and I don't know, good luck.
That's great. Very, very useful tips. And overall, very interesting interview, and I hope everyone will enjoy learning about your work and about yourself. So thanks a lot, Gabz, again, and I wish you also great luck or best luck with all your work and your future projects, and have fun watching films and playing games. Yes. So thanks a lot again, and speak to you soon.
Thank you very much, Martin, for the opportunity. Best of luck to you, and thanks for watching, guys.
Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and follow me on Facebook, Twitter or Google+. Also, if you want to learn more about design, check out my in-depth online courses on my website, yesimadesigner.com.